You're the God of this city. You're the King of these people. You're the Lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. The greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. You're the God of this city.
Hey folks, we're back again broadcasting live behind enemy lines here at Radio Free Wyatt. We're glad you could be with us tonight. I hope your week has been good. I hope you're staying safe and being healthy. And I hope you're praying, as we are, that this thing is going to pass shortly and we'll all be back to our regular lives. But I don't guess I'll ever be the same. I don't guess you'll ever be the same. I don't think church will ever be the same. I don't think our country will ever be the same. And I'll be honest with you, I don't know that that's a bad thing. And so good to have you with us tonight. Remember to stick around in 30 minutes. Justin will be coming live from the other facility on Zoom. And then eventually he will put that up and you can see what Justin's doing on Facebook. We are in Romans. Last week we gave a pretty lengthy introduction to the book about Paul writing this book, the occasion. He was really wanting to go to Rome, but he had picked up offerings from several churches, and he was going back to Jerusalem to minister to the church there that was struggling, that was coming under heavy oppression and persecution. And so he wrote this letter, probably while he was in Corinth on his third missionary journey. He probably wrote this letter to the church at Rome. The church at Rome is made up of some Romans, some Gentiles that had come to Christ, along with some Jews that had come in there and had been converted. There had been some problems between the Jews and the Gentiles there, the Romans. And so Paul is preparing them for coming, and since he had never been there to that church, he wanted to lay down a solid doctrinal, some basics, and he's going to address some things, lifestyle, doctrine, theology. As we talked last week, some people said Romans could be considered the constitution of Christianity. So what I want to do tonight is go back to verse 1, just peruse it real quick. Romans 1:1 says, Paul, I, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated under the gospel of God, which he had promised afore by his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. In verse 1, we focused last week on the word servant, that Paul was a willing servant of Christ. We focused on the word called, how Paul felt like that God had called him out on the Damascus Road. God had singled him out for purpose. We talked about being an apostle, one that is sent forth, and that Paul is not the only apostle. We are our apostles in a way. We are sent forth with the gospel, separated unto the gospel of God. And we kind of laid down, when we looked at this verse last week, how that when we're separated as believers, when we come to Christ, we're just not separated from our old lifestyle. We're just not separated from our old sin. We're separated unto something. We're separated from something, but we're separated to something. And Paul says that is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, for this week's study, verse 2 says, which he had promised afore by his prophets in the Holy Scripture. Here's what you and I need to know. The gospel, the cross, was not plan B. Paul plainly says to these folks here, the prophets spoke of Christ, Messiah, coming. He has prophesied. The gospel is nothing new. It's not the latest thing. It's always been. It was always going to be. God simply chose to work through Abraham, work through his seed, but it was always going to be about the gospel. Revelation 13:8 says that Christ was slain from the foundation of the world. And what that means, my friends, it was always going to be Jesus. It always will be about Jesus and no one else. This is a message that was sent, that God loved mankind, and God had a plan. And that's kind of the theme of the night. God had a plan. God still has a plan, and God will have a plan. And no matter what we do, God's plan is going to come to pass. What we do in living this life is, where are we going to be in that plan? How are our lives going to play out in light of God's plan? God had a plan to work through Abraham, through the Hebrew people, to reveal himself, to reveal his nature, to reveal his character. But make no mistake about it, he is the one Isaiah spoke of. He is the one to come. He is the suffering servant. He is the Lamb of God. It was always going to be. The plan was, it was always going to come to the cross of Jesus Christ. And he loves us, and he gave himself for us. So which he had promised afore, God, way before Paul was born, these people, God had promised by the prophets that Christ was coming. Verse 3 says, concerning his son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh. Now, right out of the gate, I kind of alluded to it last week, all through Romans, you're going to be dealing with election and foreknowledge and predestination. And one of the things we talked about was that in this conflict, you can't just cherry pick what you want to read in these books. You have to take it in context. And right out of the gate, we see Paul beginning to address the issue, which was the Jews and the Gentiles in the church at Rome were butting heads, kind of like what we're going through in the AM in Galatians. The Jews thought that, you know, we're God's chosen people, and you would have to become one of us. The Judaizers would say you need to keep the law, you need to be circumcised, then you can come to Christ. So there's conflict there. So right out of the gate, he says, concerning his son, Jesus Christ our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh. You see, Paul affirms that God had a plan that was orchestrated through the Jews, and it's still being carried out there in Rome and here today. So to the Gentiles in the church, he's reaffirming that God did choose to work through Abraham's seed to bring about Messiah, that Jesus was going to be born in the line of David. To the Jews, he's saying he's not only of the house of David, he is divine. He is the Son of God. Concerning his son, God's son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, that Jesus wasn't just coming for political. He wasn't coming to liberate the Jewish nation, that he was divine. He is the Lamb of God. He is God's son. He is Emmanuel, God with us, God incarnate, God in human form. So he's letting them know, yes, he came through Romans, Gentiles. God worked through the Jewish people. And Jewish people, you need to know, he didn't come for political purposes. He came to save us. Verse 4, it says, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. If you doubt the divinity of Christ, if someone says, and I've had people say this to my face, Jesus was a good teacher. Jesus was a great man. He just wasn't who he claimed to be. Or some might say, Jesus never claimed to be God. Well, that is untrue. Jesus said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. I and the Father are one. So what he's saying here is, if we doubt his divinity, show us his tomb. If you doubt Christ's divinity, if you doubt he is the Son of God, let's go lay flowers on his grave. Well, of course, people have been looking for the body of Christ for well over 2,000 years now. Listen, Christianity is hated, especially in this day we live in today. Christianity is hated all over the world. It always has been. And here's the thing. If man could have produced the body of Christ, the bone box of Christ, if they could have found something of his being, don't you know they would have done it by now? But man has exhausted millions and millions of dollars. I would venture to say that right now, over in the Middle East, there is somebody digging in the sand looking for the body of Jesus. And I want you to know they're never going to find it. James Cameron, who produced the Titanic and what's that one called? Avatar, is that the name of the one? He spent millions of dollars on an expedition. He thought he had found something. It was a fake. And I want you to know what he's saying here in verse 4, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. You see, the resurrection doesn't make Jesus divine. The resurrection shows that Jesus is divine. He's exactly who he claimed to be, and we praise God that we don't have to make a pilgrimage to Mecca or somewhere that says that Jesus is not dead. There are no bones. There is no tombstone. He is alive. Verse 5, by whom we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations. There we go, Jews. For all nations, for his name. Grace and apostleship. There are four things in this verse I want us to pull out. First of all is the word grace. Grace is how God saves us. God doesn't save us by how many prayers we pray a day. God doesn't save us by how much money we give, if we can pay indulgences or purgatory, all these things. No, grace is the vehicle by which God saves mankind. What is grace? Grace is God stooping down to mankind. Grace is God giving us. You know, we talk about this sometime here at Wyatt. Mercy is when God doesn't give us what we deserve. And that is fire and damnation and hell and the grave. It's mercy that God doesn't just destroy me. But God's grace goes even farther. Mercy, God doesn't give us what we deserve. Grace, God gives us what we don't even deserve, which is heaven, which is forgiveness, which is newness of life. Grace, it says here, grace and apostleship, God's method for salvation. None of us would have ever been saved if it hadn't been for God's grace. The second word we see here is apostleship. Now, Paul talked about apostleship in the first verse, that he is one sent forth. But in actuality, after this side of the cross, we're all apostles in a sense. We are sent forth. The Great Commission in Matthew 28 tells us that we go to our Judea, our Jerusalem, our Judea, our Samaria, our uttermost, that we are to be apostles. We're sent out with the gospel of Jesus Christ, one that was sent forth. The third word I want you to see in verse 5 is obedience. A lot of people today don't want to talk about obedience, but 1 Samuel tells us that to obey is better than sacrifice, that God would rather us be obedient. Now, our obedience doesn't bring about our salvation. We're not talking about works now, but if we are born-again Christians, we are going to submit ourselves under the mighty hand of God, that we want to be led. My children love me. My children want to please me. And if my children want to please me, they will obey me. If my children, now this is good, listen, if my children want my hand of blessing, if they want me to bless them, they will obey me. Now, if they disobey me, does that make them not my children? Absolutely not. They're my children. But if they want my hand of blessing, they're going to obey me. It's the same with God. When we come to Christ and we're born again, we're part of the family. We talked about we've been adopted in. But if we choose to be rebellious, we choose to be stiff-necked, we choose to disobey God, we're still his child, but he's going to chastise us. He's going to take us to the woodshed, and he's certainly not going to lay his hand of blessing. God never blesses rebellion. It's just not found. So, obedience by faith through grace, not by works, lest any man should boast. If we could be saved, and God knew what he was doing when he said that, if we could be saved by what we do and how good we are, number one, why would we need Christ? And number two, we'd boast in ourselves. Look what I've done. So obedience is an important thing. God desires for us to obey. We say we're of Christ, but we live like the devil, and it just shouldn't be. The last word I want you to see, it says, of all nations. Jesus came and seek and to save the lost from all nations, all colors, all creeds, every nation under the sun. The gospel is going forth to that. It doesn't matter. And you may be somebody that has a real problem with race, and you're dealing with that right now. You need to know that Jesus came and died for all men everywhere. Verse 6, I want you to see this. Among whom you are also the called of Christ. And what we're talking about here is those who are called. We're talking about the elect. Who are the called? Who are the elect? There's a lot of debate about that, and my Calvinist friends and I would sometimes disagree. I'm not Calvinist, I told you last week. I'm certainly not Arminian. I will not call myself by a man's name, and I don't think it's a good idea for anybody to do that. The Lord Jesus made it clear. He said, "My sheep hear my voice. I know them, and they follow me." He said that in John chapter 10. If you're following after anybody or anything else, then you're not part of the family. You're not one of his sheep. You are not one. The one that hears the word, the one that hears and believes and follows, that's the called. The one that comes to Christ, the one that is born again, not joining churches, not doing religious stuff, but the one that is transformed, born again, that's the called. That's the elect. That is those who are predestined. That is the church. Who are the elect? Only God knows who in his foreknowledge who the elect are. But I want to tell you, the Bible says the elect are those that are in Christ. We're not going to argue about election. Please don't send me messages, because I think I've heard it all before. It is simple as this. He calls, you answer. If he has called to your heart and you have repented of sin, you've been born again, you are of the elect. You are part of the family. You are the church. Paul assures these Roman Christians, the Jews and Gentiles, if you have been called and you have come to Christ, you are the elect. And we'll talk about that more in a few weeks. In verse 7, it says, to all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called the saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. A saint. What is a saint? Well, the Catholic Church has gotten kind of given us a definition that we all kind of live by of what a saint is. A saint is not someone we exalt. A saint in the material world is in the church, the Catholic Church. A saint would be somebody that has performed a miracle, been part of a miracle, and they've been venerated and they've been exalted. Well, that's not what a saint is in Scripture. Paul is calling the church here, the people, the Jews and the Gentiles in the church at Rome. He said, you are saints. And what that means is you're not exalted. You exalt Christ. And that is what we know. If you have been saved, it doesn't not whose family you're in and what good you've done. If you have been regenerated, if you received a new heart, if you've been born again, you're a saint. And you're not a saint that somebody's going to put your picture on a fan in a church or somebody's going to put you on television. No, it's not somebody that is exalted. A saint is somebody who is abased and they exalt Christ. That is what a saint is. A person becomes a saint when Jesus Christ becomes his Savior. And I got this from J. Vernon McGee. He said there's only two kind of people in the world. There's saints and there's ain'ts. So tonight, all the folks listening in, watching in, you fit into one of two categories. You're either a saint or you ain't. And you say, Brother Scott, what's the difference in that? Is there an hour, a time, a date, and a place where you were born? You've got a birth certificate saying where you were born. It's very detailed. Who your parents were. You've got a birth certificate that says how much you weighed when you were born. You've got a birth certificate that says how long you were when you were born. It is very detailed. It says the very hour in which you were physically born into this world. My dear friends, if you are born again, it didn't happen over days and weeks and months and years. No, you are born again. You are saved when God convicts you of your sin and you confess your sin to God and you repent of that sin and God takes all of that guilt and shame. It says, behold, all the old things pass away. Behold, all things become new. You become a new creature in Christ. And how do you know if it was real? Because you're brand new. And you hate what you used to love, and you love what you used to hate. And you seek not to satisfy your own flesh and lust. You seek to satisfy what Christ would have you be. So you're either a saint or ain't, J. Vernon says. And then so to Rome, he says to the Jew, look at verse 7 with me again. To all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father. Peace. You know, I heard of a survey, this has been many years ago, that they did of just a general sampling of American citizens. And they said, what is the one thing that you're looking for in life? And you and I would think it would be, well, people are looking for money, power, love, sex, relationships. But you know what the number one answer came back, the predominant answer? People were looking for peace. They were looking for peace in their marriage. They're looking for peace in their home. They're looking for peace in the streets. But mostly they were looking for peace in their hearts. And Paul says, peace from God. That's where it comes from. And the Lord Jesus Christ. Peace to you from God through Jesus. You see, people make gods out of all kind of things in all kind of places. But the God of the Bible, the God of heaven and earth, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. If you say you believe in this God of the Bible, you need to know that there's only one avenue to get to that God. You say that's very narrow-minded. Well, so be it. Jesus said, I am the truth in John 14:6. I am the way, I'm the life. Then Jesus said, I need you to hear this, friends. Jesus said, no man comes to the Father but by me. That means the only way to peace, the only way you can ever be reconciled to God, the only way you will ever see heaven and miss hell, the only way the Bible says that we can have life right here, life and life more abundant, and we can have life in eternity in heaven, Jesus said, I'm the only way. So we have to decide what we're going to do about Jesus. We can't vote him out of office. We can't impeach him. You've got to either reject him or accept him. There's no other way. Listen, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We're going to stop right there because Paul's going to change gears in verse 8, and we're going to do that next week. I got a couple of things I want to talk to you about before we're going to pitch it over to Justin in about 9 minutes. First of all, I want to talk to you about the offering. Our first week of offering that we weren't together, it did pretty good. It pretty much met budget, but I got to talk to you about the offering this week. We're counting offering right now from Monday to Sunday, and so Monday morning, Nancy gave me the totals from this past week's offering. And some of you are thinking like, oh, and I told one person earlier today, I might as well say it, I was telling Mr. Clayton back there, and he goes, oh, how bad was it? And I said, man, our offering this week was like a good regular Sunday when the church is together. And I said, praise God. I love you folks. I've served in several churches, and I've been doing this 29 years almost. And you are the salt of the earth. You are the greatest church. And I'm so proud to be your pastor. That it's pretty much known in church work that when you miss on a snow day or something like that, you don't have church, you never get that offering back. People don't the next Sunday double up. That's just the reality of things in church work. Every preacher I know will tell you the same thing. So going into this crazy time we're in where we're not meeting for who knows how long, a lot of people worried about the church being able to keep up with their obligations financially. So imagine when we got those figures this week that it was a great offering as if we were all together in this place. So I just want to say thank you. God bless you for putting your faith where your mouth is and not just giving lip service to the church and to your love for the Lord, not just giving lip service for your love of missions and the love of your staff and the love of your church. God bless you. So I just had to say that to you. I was thinking about sending it through the deacon ministry. I didn't want to put it on Facebook because other churches might not be doing so well. But I just had to say something to you because I love you and I'm so proud to be your pastor. And so Sunday morning, I want you to see what we're doing. Sunday morning, we continue with our series, Roots, Living the Gospel. And this week, it's called The Unnatural Walk. We're going to talk about this Sunday. Tune in, same bat time, same bat channel. The young folks have no idea what that means, but you old folks do. Do you even know? Yeah, Batman came on the same time, same channel every week. Be here, same bat time, same bat channel, Sunday morning at 10 o'clock. We're going to talk about the unnatural walk, that what God has called us to be is very unnatural to our heart, to our life, to our culture. We kind of have to walk a whole new way. So that's Sunday morning. Sunday night, we're going to be back with Table for Three. And it's a little scary this week. I will be driving the train this week. I'll be in the middle seat. And we're going to be looking at Obadiah. Obadiah, the one that worked for Jezebel and Ahab. And we're going to talk about whether that's the same Obadiah, the prophet. And we're going to talk about some things, just a few short verses. But I want you to know it's going to be a good lesson looking at this man and the position he was in, the service that where he was, and how he bloomed in such a dark, dark place. All right, I think that's all I've got for you. Oh, I forgot about my first thing I need to talk to you about, didn't I? I got out of order. Can you find that one, put it up? Here's what we're asking you to do. Between now and Easter, this is what we need you to do. Record a 3-minute testimony. 3 minutes, very, very short. A 3-minute video. Just take your phone, get someone in your family, and give your testimony. Who you were before Christ, how you came to know Christ as your Savior, and number three, how your life has been changed by Christ. So a 3-minute, and then at the end, if you want to get your family together and say hi to everybody and a little greeting that we can pass it around the church, we can see each other on Easter, do that. A 3-minute video, your testimony, and then we want you to upload it Easter morning. Okay, Easter morning, we want everybody to do this. Upload your testimony to Facebook. Do what now?
Upload that is uplifting.
It's an upload that is uplifting. That's very good. So we're going to inundate. We're going to flood the internet, Facebook, with testimonies. But we want you to hashtag it. There, put it on the screen for them there. We are Wyatt. Hashtag we are Wyatt. And that way when you go search for them, you can search that hashtag and you can see all the Wyatt folks' testimony. So go ahead. I may do one between now and then, kind of do a little example for you. But that is going to be an awesome way, a different way. We can't celebrate Easter this year, it's looking like, regularly. So this is a new way, digitally. We are going to bring praise and honor to the Lord with the We Are Wyatt campaign. All right. Justin's got about 4 minutes. Folks have downloaded Zoom. If not, you'll catch up with later. We love you. God bless you. And we will see you later.
There's a day that's drawing near, when this darkness breaks to light and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eye.